This is Merryn Jose, and you're listening to Merlian Podcasts. Today, we have the great pleasure of speaking with Jorge Luis Delgado. Jorge Luis Delgado received training with shamans in the region northeast of Lake Titicaca and studied with the Quiero elders of the Cusco region, the last remaining spiritual descendants of the Incas. Jorge is known as a leading authority on Inca culture and spiritual practices. He serves as a teacher and guide to the Sacred Valley and other Andean sacred sites. He is also the author of Andean Awakening, an Inca Guide to Mystical Peru. So welcome to Merlian Podcast, Jorge Luis Delgado.
Thank you.
May I call you Jorge?
Yes, please.
Okay. For my first question, in your book, Andean Awakening, an Inca Guide to Mystical Peru, you write that the world is entering a new Pachacuti, the return of the light after 500 years of darkness, and that 2012 is an important year in this new cycle. Can you explain to our listeners what Pachacuti is?
Pachacuti means the return to the essence of the cosmos. We believe that the cycle, the smallest cycle, is the day and the night. And the largest cycle is 1,000 years, and also part of it is night, part of it is daytime. So we believe that in South America, when the Spaniards arrived, they arrived by a sunset. They arrived by 1492. So 400 years later, by 1992, we start a new sunrise.
Uh-huh.
And this new sunrise, you know, takes a little time too. I mean, remember, it's 500 years of daytime.
Yeah.
So we are now in the middle of the sunrise, and we believe by the 2012, the sun we will see in full.
I see. And what will this mean to our planet and us as spiritual beings?
What is important to understand from this new cycle is that this is the cycle when we start to awakening. As we rest during the night, at the daytime, everything starts to remember the essence. We say the potato, for example, when the sun rises, the potato remembers it is a potato, and that's the best to reproduce as much possible.
Yes.
The animal remember that they are, or the llama remembers it's a llama, but the people, what we have to remember? What we have to remember is that we are the children of the sun. And as a children of the sun, we remember our essence.
So it really is a true awakening, a new awareness.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And you say also in your book that this is a time of return to joy.
Yes. When we remember our essence, we remember our gifts. And in our tradition, we believe that we have three important gifts, which is Munai, love, Yanghai, service, Yachai, wisdom. This is the three attributes of the Father Sun, and it's the three attributes of the Mother Earth. However, we are children of the Father Sun and the Mother Earth, we have these three attributes. And these attributes, for us, guarantees the permanent joy. Nothing from outside, nothing that sometimes we want to manifest from the material world will guarantee us the permanent joy, except the encounter with our own essence, the encounter with our own spirit.
Yes.
So all this love, the wisdom, and the service brings back the wisdom to all of us.
Oh, that's wonderful. I have two questions here, really, so I'll start with the first one. One is about the Inca doorway, and the second is how you became a chacaruna. So let's begin with the legendary Inca doorway. I think you said it was called Aramuru, is that correct?
Yes. Nowadays, most of the people call Aramuru.
Mm-hmm.
But the old name is Wilka Uta, which means the house of the sun, which means the house of divinity, the house of God. That some journalist interviewed me about my experience when I arrived to the place, and I told them about my experience in many aspects, and one of the things was I noticed like somebody was going through this doorway.
Mm-hmm.
And when they asked me, who do you think was this person going through the doorway? And, I told them, it was probably Aramuru. And who is Aramuru?
Yes.
Aramuru is a great master who came from Lemuria with a very special mission to bring the solar disk from there to this continent. And this continent had the disk in order to avoid the resistance, in order to expand the consciousness. So the Inca become the children of the sun. So this was a very important gift that we had from the masters. So the legend says when Aramuru finished his mission in this reality, he returned after he gave the solar disk to the children of the sun, to the Incas.
Mm-hmm.
He returned, the legend says, by a doorway around Lake Titicaca. So when I had the experience at the doorway, I saw like somebody was going through the doorway. So I thought that it was could be Aramuru. But anyway, what is important for us is not exactly the name, but the name helps us to remember the connection with Lemuria,
yes,
the connection with the solar disk, the connection with the illumination temple, which is on the etheric level of Lake Titicaca, and the inner retreat that we have for the solar disk under the waters of Lake Titicaca.
That's really amazing. You also mentioned you are known as a chacaruna, a bridge person, one who helps others to cross one side of the river to the other. How does one become a chacaruna? Are you chosen? Is it a natural process?
In this new cycle, many, many chacarunas are born because we need many chacarunas. Because in this great awakening, many people start to be aware about their gifts, to be aware about the presence, about the consciousness, about life, about energy. So in our tradition, we have different names, you know. We don't have the word shaman. Of course, we use in some cities, but it's not native from our tradition.
I see.
Okay?
Yes.
So we have the Paco, Pampamisa, Altomisa, Curajacuya, we have the Yatiri, Colliri, Chamacani, different names, different languages like Quechua, Aymara. But the most important for us to be a chacaruna probably is one of the simple ways to say who you are, because the chacaruna is always ready for the service.
Yes.
And this service comes from Munai, from love, and it comes from Yachay, which is the wisdom. So the important thing is the first step of our chacaruna is to build the bridge between the mind and the heart.
Oh, I understand.
And in this way, as much we go through this bridge, we start to make the bridge wider, wider and wider until the bridge disappears, you know?
Yes, yes.
Because the truth is that the reason that bridge, after all, is one. But the thing is, it's important, you know, to have the model, the idea. Bridge is chacana, chacaruna, and chacaruna is the bridge person.
Mm.
So as bridge person, you start to bridge with the inner world, with the upper world. As much you do the service, you become building bridges with other realities.
I see, yes.
So it is a kind of expansion of the consciousness that not necessarily means a title, you know?
Oh, I understand.
Or a hierarchy.
Yes.
So I believe that it's very important not necessarily to have a title in this new day when we understand the process of expansion of the consciousness doesn't have an end.
Yes, I understand. I think in the West we call these people light workers, they're of service. So we can all become chacarunas then, is that correct?
Of course.
Yes. Now, I find something interesting here too. Why is the number 49 so important in the pre-Inca traditions?
Well, in many of the temples around Lake Titicaca, like Tiwanaku, like the Colla civilization, we found that the temple has 24 stones on one side, 24 on the other side, and in the middle one. So 48 plus 1, 49.
Mm-hmm.
And we have a flag, very important flag, that it has 7 colors. The rainbow colors in 7 square pieces.
Oh.
By another 7 square pieces, the colors of the rainbow. So in total, we have 49 pieces, which is a very special number, and it is now the flag of the pre-Incan civilization. But anyway, nowadays it is the flag of the Aymaras, Quechuas, from the nations, from the Andes, from the highlands. But long time ago, we've been connected with an organization we call Rama Group, that we do the spaceship brother connection, you know, and and meditations with some other friends from Bolivia and from Peru.
Yes.
We got some information, and the message, we've been asking, why is 49 stones on these temples, you know, because in one of these temples, for example, the Sankan temple, it has many, many faces of different races, different colors. But the thing is, how did they know that there is these colors?
Of course. It's
just races in the other parts of the world, you know?
Yes.
So we thought that they were like a masters or teachers from all the traditions, from all the root races of the planet, you know? And maybe from other planets as well.
Yes, maybe.
So when we had the answer about why the 49, the Space Brothers told us that it was 49 guides. Guides came from the space to help.
Oh, how interesting. Will you write about that in another book at all, do you think?
Yes. We are working right now. The other book, it's called, well, it's ready. It is called Pachacuti, The Return to Joy. You know, Pachacuti means the return to the essence of the cosmos.
Yes.
But what is the essence of the cosmos, you know? I believe it's joy.
Yes.
Which is the state of the consciousness of the spirit. It's happy with no reason at all. You know, however, we are too busy in the mind on this new sunrise when we find our essence, when we know who we are, you know, the name of this time also we call Taripai Pacha, the time to find yourself, which is a very, very, very important word for us because it has to do with this shift of the consciousness. This is a great awakening and the people find the authentic self. We can see people is searching, is trying to find something. Sometimes people change the houses, the cars, the partners, change jobs, change everything. But they think, sometimes we think that the problem is outside and we don't change ourselves. You know? So this big change, this big shift, it has to do with the awareness, with the meaning of life.
Well, thank you for that. Can you share with us what the three worlds of Inca mythology are and what they mean?
Yes, actually, there are four worlds, but normally is known as the trilogy, because this is something that we can put some symbols, you know. The first is the inner world, you know, that is represented by the snake. The inner world, Ukupacha. In Aymara, it's Mankapacha. I like this word in Aymara because it says, Manka means to eat. So there is an aspect of the Mother Earth, this inner world, that eats and transforms. Okay? So that's why the snake is the symbol.
Would that be the same as the Kundalini, which is represented by the snake, that inner power?
It is one of the ways, one of the aspects. Everything is multidimensional.
Yes, of course.
Yes, but there is this other aspect which is very, very important in our tradition. In our tradition, it is about releasing the pains, the sorrows, the guilty feelings, you know, anything that it hurt us in the past and we carry with us, you know, that's not good for us. So we call hucha. Hucha means heavy energy. Okay?
Yeah.
So for us it's very, very important to release all the heavy energies, all the fear, you know?
Yes, there's a lot of fear.
Yeah. So these heavy energies doesn't help us to find ourselves. These heavy energies, it brings to us more heavy energy. It attracts all the heavy energy.
Yes.
And we expand, and instead to expand our own light, we expand fear in all our planet. So the point is, the Mother Earth is always ready, very happy, to eat and transform the heavy energy.
I see.
So we know the snake has the secret to shade their pain, the sorrow, the guilty feeling, the years. You never see an old snake, huh?
No.
They know the secret.
Yes, yes, they shed their skins.
The other world, this world, is represented by the puma. And the puma is the courage to face what we need to face. The puma is the balance. Puma is the stalker, is the warrior. But also, puma is the less ego animal. The puma does what he needs to do without calling the attention of anybody. So it's the less ego animal. The puma, most of the time, walks alone. Part of the spiritual journey is lonely, because only you can pull out whatever you need to pull out from this inner world. By other way, the snake represents this wisdom, this light, as you release the heavy energies. We have a beautiful legend about Sachamama and Yakumama. As much they've been releasing the heavy energies, they start to learn to walk like a human being. Okay?
Yes.
And however they work with the water, with the emotions, you know, releasing heavy energy too. One becoming a rainbow, and the other one in lightning.
In lightning?
Yes, lightning and rainbow. For us, this is the origin of the rainbow and lightning, which is the essence, the manifestation of the light, you know?
Yes.
That everybody can do it. The other world we call the Hanam Pacha or Alah Pacha in Aymara, in Quechua, is the upper world. But this world is represented by the condor. And the condor is a symbol of the freedom, the symbol of infinity and eternity. And the condor has a big picture of all the life in this reality. So as we release heavy energies, we face with courage what we need to face, you know, we can fly. And when we fly, we see that everything we experience in life is good.
That's so we have the snake, the puma, and the condor.
And the fourth I was mentioning is the Fawahpacha.
Yes.
The Fawahpacha is this non-visible world, the world that is connected with other realms.
Mm.
This is the other dimensions.
I see. There seems to be so much talk about global warming and the stress on the natural resources of our planet. Can you tell us, in your view, what's happening on the planet?
You know, the mind always will find something to be worried. And as much we enter in the new cycle, you know, in the new day, everything goes upside down, you know?
Ah, yes, I understand.
And when everything is upside down, you know, the heavy energy is also upside down, and it comes, you know, it's moving.
Mm.
And everywhere the people start to be concerned about one aspect, the other aspect. You know, there's different worries of the people in the world. But what is important for us, it is not really what is going on with this aspect only.
Mm.
You know,
yes.
The other aspect is that we are in a different frequency of sun, in a different frequency of the Mother Earth.
Mm.
And this new frequency it brings the return of the common sense of the people.
Ah,
this global warming is part of the process as well. You know,
yes.
There are some things that is supposed to happen anyway. We have to learn.
Yes.
When we don't learn something, it comes in cycles. It returns again.
Yes, it repeats.
It seems that there is something we have to go through it, you know?
Yes.
And what is important for us to don't expand the fear, it is about to return to our essence, to the consciousness of the human beings, not only material, also spiritual. And this way, everybody is aware what to do, but not based in the fear.
Yes.
What to do based in love. When we have an answer in what to do based in love, everybody is going to be with the spirit always happy without the extreme worry.
Yes.
So we believe that this global warming, it happened many times
mm-hmm.
in our planet.
That's right.
But of course, we did some mistakes. We did something wrong, and we always have the opportunity from the Mother Earth who loves us so much, from the Father Sun who loves us so much, and we have ways and opportunities to grow and expand the consciousness.
So, Jorge, thank you so much today for your wisdom, your wise words. We look forward to you coming back again on the show. Do you have a website?
Yes, we have the book Andean Awakening.
Yes.
And we have this web, andeanawakening.com.
Oh, I think it's
www.andeanawakening.com. .com. And the other one is contiki@contikiperu.com.
Okay. For our listeners, please also go to www.merliannews.com to read the book review on Andean Awakening, An Inca Guide to Mystical Peru. This is Merryn Jose.